It has been 50 years since the landmark Title IX became law. Since then, much progress has been made in dismantling gender barriers that once prevented women and men from realizing their dreams because of their sex. Aloha, I'm Jody Leong. Tonight we bring you the inspirational stories of people whose lives have been forever transformed by Title IX, the far-reaching impacts on education and women's sports, and how the law has shaken up our workforce. We'll also take a look at the challenges that remain and hopes for the next 50 years. More than ever before, young women and men have opportunities that were unheard of before the passage of Title IX in 1972. The landmark law not only leveled the playing field for women in college athletics, but also opened doors for all students to follow their dreams in fields of study without gender barriers. Before Title IX, only 16% of all college athletes were women. By 2020, women accounted for 45% of all NCAA athletes. Before Title IX, women earned only 9% of all medical school degrees and 7% of all law degrees. Today, they earn nearly half of all degrees in each field. Before Title IX, there was only one woman judge in the state of Hawaii. Today, women account for about 50% of all judges in this state.
Title IX has been a game changer for women across the board.
Hawaii Supreme Court Justice Sabrina McKenna is among the early beneficiaries of Title IX and a lifelong advocate for women's rights.
I grew up being raised by a single mom after my dad died when I was 9. And I saw how she struggled after my father died and what she went through in terms of discrimination, I think race and gender discrimination in the workplace. I saw it. I remember thinking someday I'm going to get a good education, and when I grow up and I get a good education, I want to give back to the community, and I'm not going to treat people the way people treated my mother.
McKenna's mother saw her graduate from law school and become a successful attorney, law school professor, and judge. But despite Title IX, McKenna still experienced some of the same discrimination that her mother once did years before.
I can't forget this interview that I had with a partner at a law firm where he asked me, "Do you realize that if you come to work for a firm, you can't leave during the day to go to PTA meetings?"
While practicing law in downtown Honolulu, McKenna came to the realization there was still much work to be done when a senior partner in her law firm introduced her to a bank executive.
And he said, "This is Sabrina McKenna. She just joined our firm." And the executive said, "Oh, so whose secretary are you?" You know, just assuming that a woman would be a secretary and not a lawyer. It's unfortunate, but those types of implicit biases continue to exist.
As a coach, I see it every day.
That's it, Mac. That's the volume right there. Good, good.
I get told all of the time that my job as the women's basketball coach isn't as high-pressured as, say, the men's coach. Across the country, there is inequity with the coaches' salaries between men's and women's, not only head coaches, but assistant coaches. And we do the same job.
University of Hawaii Rainbow Wahine head basketball coach Laura Beeman is doing her part to perpetuate the intent of Title IX among her players.
For me, not only being able to show them what sports have done for me in a profession that was very male-dominated 30, 40 years ago, but to be able to tell them, go get what you want, go be who you want to be.
That was the future envisioned by Title IX co-author, the late Hawaii Congresswoman Patsy Mink, after her own dreams of becoming a doctor were dashed by gender discrimination. Mink was denied admission to at least 10 medical schools because she was a woman. She was accepted to the University of Chicago Law School, where she was one of two women in her class. Mink would eventually become the first woman of color elected to the U.S. House of Representatives and the first Asian American woman to serve in Congress. After her death, Title IX was renamed the Patsy T. Mink Equal Opportunity in Education Act.
And although sports was not included in the 37 words that make up Title IX, athletics is where the law initially made its biggest impact.
Patsy Meek, I think, knew that it would also include athletics.
But McKenna doesn't believe Congress and President Nixon, who signed the bill into law, were aware that athletics would be covered by Title IX.
When people realized that it would also mean there needed to be equality in athletics, there was a huge backlash. Congress tried to amend the law.
But Patsy Meek prevailed. The groundbreaking law has had far-reaching impacts for both women and men in classrooms, boardrooms, science labs, and of course, in women's athletics. Coming up, how Title IX has changed the face of women's sports. Title IX had perhaps the most immediate impact and made the biggest splash on women's sports. Great strides have been made in removing gender barriers and inequities, but the landmark law is also changing attitudes and the face of athletic programs in our schools. Allison Chang is a game-winning place kicker on the Iolani school football team. Eddie Wheeler is a cheerleader on Kalani High School's pep squad. These high school students are breaking barriers in the gym and on the field, following their unique dreams thanks to Title IX.
I'm so happy that, you know, now we live in a society where it's not a big deal if there's a guy on the cheer team, if there's a girl playing football.
Just follow your passion, do what you want to do, and it'll take you so far. Like, you'll be amazed at what you can do if you just try.
Both Chang and Wheeler realize the opportunities they have today are the result of years of struggle by those who came before them.
When I was an athlete, when we received hand-me-down uniforms.
The men got their laundry done after practice, and the women, they were like, no, that's not happening.
And it was a real struggle. There was opposition, you know, and we don't blame the men. There was limited resources.
They slept four to a room on the road trip, and they were fine. They got $6 to eat on or something.
Their first trip, they stopped the bus so that the boys could get off and go have their pregame meal, but the girls stayed on the bus because there is no budget for the meals for the girls. Well, that doesn't happen anymore, so we've made progress.
It didn't all happen right away. It did not. It was a very slow process. I mean, UH was saddled back then with very little funds. We saw little bit by little bit, scholarships were added.
Former Rainbow Wahine volleyball head coach Dave Shoji recalls when women competed in only three sports.
We had tennis and volleyball, track and field, but you know, nowadays it's a full slate. And I think women are treated better and you know, they get the same facilities, they get practice times, they get the same scholarships. And so that didn't happen back in the 70s or 80s. The women have come a long, long way.
Fewer than 32,000 women participated in college sports when Title IX became law in 1972. That represented less than 16% of all college athletes. By 2020, that number was nearly 223,000, about half of all college athletes. Today, women are playing competitive sports to large crowds and winning Olympic medals. Rob DeMello talks to a homegrown Olympic medalist, a beneficiary of Title IX, who is now trailblazing for the next generation.
My mama said, hey girl, you can rule the world. She said, hey girl, you can rule the world.
As a junior at Roosevelt High School in 1998, Eva Beach raised Clarissa Chun made the transition from judo to wrestling, where after claiming 5 national titles as a judoka, she was convinced to don a singlet, providing a chance to make history, as Hawaii was the first state in the country to sanction girls wrestling as a sport. And Chun delivered, winning the 98-pound state title in back-to-back seasons.
It's interesting to me now, looking back, is thinking about what it took to get it sanctioned, to make it happen, you know, because it doesn't happen overnight like that. I'm so grateful for that because, you know, I wouldn't be where I am today.
Now, despite being a 2-time state wrestling champion, Chun initially had no plans to compete at the collegiate level. instead was locked in on attending the University of Iowa with the intention of majoring in communications and perhaps be a manager for the national championship men's team, since the Hawkeyes did not offer women's wrestling.
Really, the turning point came when Missouri Valley College sent a packet saying, hey, they're starting the first collegiate scholarship program. Really just thought, why not? You know, my brother really was the one that told me, go for it.
And the rest is history. While under scholarship at Missouri Valley College, Chun was a multiple-time tournament champion, opening the door to find success on a much larger stage, which was a legendary run for Team USA at 105 pounds. As the first ever Hawaii native to qualify for a U.S. Olympic wrestling team, she'd win 6 gold medals between the World and Pan American Games, capping off her illustrious career with a bronze medal finish at the 2012 Olympics in London.
You know, as much as it is an individual sport, it takes so many people to get to that, right? My family, the community, the state of Hawaii. There were moments where it felt like pressure, but at the same time, it was more how awesome is this? Because you feel that mana, that energy, that power, from where we're from.
10 years after her Olympic triumph at the age of 41 and a member of the USA Wrestling Hall of Fame, Chun continues to pave an unprecedented path, becoming the first ever head coach of a Power 5 wrestling program, ironically enough, at the University of Iowa. In 2022, there are now over 100 programs across the country that offer women's wrestling. And although the University of Hawaii is not one of them, Chun is already creating opportunities for the next generation of island grapplers, having brought in 4-time state champ Nanea Estrella of Maui as part of her very first Hawkeye recruiting class.
That is poetic, you know, it is important to me, representation from Hawaii.
Without a doubt, the enactment of Title IX 50 years ago created possibilities for Chun that have gone beyond her wildest dreams. And in return, she's hoping to allow others from the island to dream as well.
What Patsy Mink fought for were these opportunities so that woman could have an education. And it's a responsibility, to continue that legacy.
When we come back, Beyond Sports, how Title IX is changing the landscape of our workforce.
Title IX's dramatic effect on women's sports has empowered young women all over the world, giving them the confidence and the belief that they can achieve even their wildest dreams. And that has created a revolution of sorts in our workforce. Here's Pamela Young.
This is how Jamie Thompson starts her day, watching the planes land and take off from the Aeronautics Training Center. When she graduates from Honolulu Community College, she'll be certified as an aviation mechanic. Give carpentry graduate Trish Ramos a hammer and nails, and she'll start building you a house. Single mom Shira Salima Doman enrolled in the apprenticeship program and is now a submarine painter blaster at Pearl Harbor. All three had initial doubts about entering male-dominated fields.
The blasting is extremely physical, and for me, I was like, this is a man's job, I can't do this.
And they were looking at me funny, are you sure you'd be able to handle the work? And I responded, what's that supposed to mean? We train side by side with you. I don't see what the problem is.
A Society of Professional Engineers study shows girls perform equally well as boys in STEM subjects, science, technology, engineering, and math, up until high school. This is usually when societal expectations mold their career choices, when they're told, a pretty girl like you doesn't want to get her hands dirty. Brianna Yamada didn't listen.
They underestimated what we could do, whether it was getting our hands dirty. It was a constant battle to just prove yourself and say that you could keep up with the boys. I am a generation engineer. I am problem solving, looking at technical documents, or we're out in the field. We're crawling through tunnels, we're in the boiler, we're inspecting the turbine, and it's not only hot and sweaty, but we're getting dirty as well. It's an environment that, I think is exciting, and it's really fun to be out in the open and working with others. Maybe being a female in a male-dominant field, I feel that if you show respect, you gain respect back.
STEM graduates like Brianne are finding their way into schools and professions in increasing numbers since Title IX. When Patsy Mink was rejected from medical school, only 5% of medical students were female. Today, 52.
I never felt that I was lesser. I think that's the great thing about Title IX and what Patsy Mink did for us, is that I never had to compromise who I was. I can be Dr. Ping when I'm at work. I can be Mommy when I'm at home. I can be Auntie Jen when I'm volunteering. I really think that that's what has really benefited me and my generation.
The law opened the doors to these women, but equal educational access also meant lowering barriers for men.
Historically, the first nurses were men, tending to the battle wounded. It wasn't until 1960 they were allowed in the largest nurses' union. But the medical field and the public have now seen a real need for male nurses.
We do offer a different perspective and a different vibe. It's nice. People are starting to accept change. We may have some patients that are combative. When they do see a male nurse, they might think, this person might actually have more authority. So, you know, we have to behave.
Sigrid says he's fortunate to go to school in a time when gender plays no role in one's chosen profession.
You just got to keep going, no matter what people say. Keep pursuing it and everything else will fall into place.
And it has to go into the... Good.
You know, when I was in school, I was the only one. A lot of clients or customers would look at me and go, wait, I don't want a male working on me or touching me.
But Kevin persisted, got his cosmetology certification, and now teaches the craft to HCC students.
Title IX has allowed males in our industry to pursue what they really love.
Back in the old days, more women, back in the 50s, 60s, male is very limited until the 70s, and males start coming in and leading and become dominant in the industry.
At the Paul Brown Salon and Day Spa, 60% of the stylists are men.
You want to become a hairdresser, and that's something you feel that you can do with your life, then do it. Don't let nothing stop you. Don't let anybody make a negative comment. Just do what you love.
Even after 50 years, changing societal attitudes is a slow-moving process. And today, the amendment challenges other biases against sexual identity, pregnancy-related discrimination, and sexual violence on campuses. While tremendous advances have been made, educators and students are learning the true way to live the law is to eliminate all preconceptions of who you are and who you can be.
Coming up, paying it forward, looking to future generations to carry Title IX into the next 50 years.
We have come so far in the last 50 years, but things aren't completely equal yet.
So I think over the next 50 years, it's continuing to expand the knowledge, it's continuing to expand the education, it's continuing to expand the equality of pay, opportunity.
And we need to remain vigilant because there's always backlash and there's always people that want to retrench and take away rights.
A state Supreme Court justice and women's basketball head coach are among those working tirelessly to ensure that Patsy Mink's legacy lives on in future generations.
So I would just tell my girls, stand up for what you believe and go get it.
Well, it's just so rewarding to see this happen because rightfully so, women should be treated equally as men. And I think the women are almost there, but it's still an uphill battle.
I mean, there's always pushback, right? From people who are afraid that if you get something, that means they're losing something.
So I think the education that this is not an us against them is huge. I think that it's opened the eyes of a lot of men to say, wow, I have a daughter, and I don't want to have to look my daughter in the eye and say she can't do something because she's a girl.
I would like to see more females in leadership positions as CEOs of healthcare companies. Right now, we only have 15% of all healthcare CEOs who are female. And I think that makes a huge impact on our industry.
If this is what you're meant to do or meant to be doing and you love it, you have a passion for it, don't let anything or anyone bring you down.
I hope that everyone can continue to just pursue their passions, but most importantly, not care about what other people think.
It'll take a community to build on progress made in the last 50 years and to move Title IX forward to the next generation. Events like this at the University of Hawaii at Manoa Stan Sheriff Center recently involved women and men athletes, their coaches, community businesses, and women's rights advocates. The event raised hundreds of thousands of dollars to fund nutritional and mental health support, supplies, and equipment for women athletes.
I think we all have an obligation and a duty, but also we're blessed to be able to give back to the community. I want people, young people, to know that things were different when I was their age, and they see where I am now, but you know, there's a lot of people that had to struggle to allow people like me to be in the position that I am. I stand on the shoulder of giants, tiny giants sometimes, like Patsy Mink.
Patsy Takemoto Mink, who once said the purpose of this bill is really to free the human spirit, to make it possible for everyone to achieve according to their talents and wishes.
Be that proud woman, and then when you get there, pay it forward to that next young lady. Pay it forward to that little girl that says, well, can I be a coach in the NFL? Can I be an astronaut? Absolutely.
The intent of Title IX was to provide a roadmap for this journey to equality for all. It gives us not only permission to pursue our goals in education, sports, and the workplace, but the legal right to do so without stereotypical barriers. Title IX is the license to be our true, authentic selves.